GearNetwork.com.
The following is a presentation of the Gear Radio Network.
I believe it's a big challenge for our building to keep things in perspective and to if we're going to get addicted to anything, let's get addicted to the process.
And with that, we welcome you to Trust the Podcast, powered by Better Live Than Dead and the Gear Radio Network. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the episode John has been waiting for.
Say it.
This is episode number 69.
Woohoo! My favorite number. What a nice episode we're at, Ryan. Episode 69, people.
Man, I love it how you couldn't even wait for me to say it. You started saying my line. I love it. It cracks me up. I've been thinking about this, and this is kind of breaking the fourth wall. It's Saturday, the 24th of October, my brother's birthday, who I actually have to call. I just realized that I have not called him today. I don't call people much.
Happy birthday, Eric.
Happy birthday to Eric. Many, many more happy birthdays to come after this one, but enjoy the day.
Yes, enjoy the day and the night, my friend.
We're not enjoying the day because we're going to talk about the Buffalo Bills versus Kansas City Chiefs, as mentioned, episode 69. You can hear us on BetterLiveThanBed.com.
Yeah, 69, okay. Nice.
GearNetwork.com and wherever.
You know what? We could just end the episode right there. That's the entire episode for me.
The only funnier thing than that would be if the podcast lasted 6 minutes and 9 seconds. That would be better. Or minutes and 20 seconds.
We can make that happen. Let's just stick commercials in right now and then come back and say goodbye. Or fill the time with whatever.
Whatever works for you. I'm cool with whatever. So we're doing the podcast on Saturday, the day before the Buffalo Bills take on the New York Jets, which we will talk about in just a few minutes towards the end of the podcast. But I don't know about you, John. I know you missed the Bills and Titans talk. Like I said before we went on the air, I was more bummed out about that game because I thought Buffalo actually had a chance. Mm-hmm. Whereas here against Kansas City, you kind of went in and it's a measuring stick. Because mm-hmm. Kansas City defending Super Bowl champions and all that jazz, among other things. But this game was kind of just like, whatever. And that's kind of how I feel about the podcast this week. I'm going to give it my all. I'm going to give you the 100% I always give. Got a nice hot cup of coffee here. Got some water. I'm watching UFC 254. I'm ready to go. We're going to make this happen.
But
Buffalo did not look very good on what was it? It was Monday afternoon. That's right. That's the other thing too.
Monday early evening. Yeah. Well, COVID.
That's the other thing. Is that these games
thrown everything off for a loop that it's been almost. I don't want to say impossible, but it has been very, very hard to coordinate a consistent schedule, especially with this particular podcast because it's dedicated solely to. Well, I don't want to say solely. Ever since I came on board, I added shtick to it, but. But it's a Bills talk podcast for all intents and purposes. Listen in, we haven't been able to do for 3 weeks between my schedule and Brandon's. But then, like, you figure all the different, game changes. And I mean, the Bills Titans game was moved, I think, 3 or 4 times.
Yeah.
Alone.
Not to even mention, John, like you and I, we have a good system, I think, to kind of break down for all those who've been listening for these last 69 episodes. And I'm going to try to get that in as many times as I can today. The last 69 episodes. Yeah. You kind of get a feel. Now with myself and Dell, we did it when Dell was available because obviously we all know Dell's a super busy dude. But when John came on the podcast, it was very much I text John on Sunday and I say, hey, when do you want to do this? But these past couple weeks with the games being switched around, it has just completely thrown us off our game and we are sorry for that, but we're still here to talk about.
I don't apologize. The hell with y'all.
Well, I'm sorry if they were looking to listen to it earlier in the week. I apologize for that, but I'm not apologizing for anything else because we're here.
You held down the fort the last episode, and it was great.
I'll tell you what, like I mentioned last week, it was the first time I had recorded a podcast by myself since I did it in Hawaii, so I was kind of bummed about that, but it's all good.
All right.
Before we talk about the recap, but the rundown, I should mention, by the way, I'm Ryan Wolfe at Wolfe BLTD. John is at IamJCMoney, joining me on the IndyCard Media Hotline. Now, John, Buffalo sputters in their loss to Kansas City 26-17. The score does not reflect the actual outcome here. The Chiefs were much better than the Buffalo Bills. Now, for me, John, the equivalent of this game was like those viral TikToks you see where you've got someone who's struggling to drunkenly hold on to the mechanical bull. and then they get yeeted into oblivion, and then you laugh your ass off. That's kind of what this game felt like. It was like Jesus Buffalo was holding on for dear life. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. Thump, and they get thrown off, and you're like, oh my God, that was hilarious.
Hey, listen, that's kind of how I felt. I am not of the TikTok generation. I know of TikTok. I don't use it. Evidently, I found out a couple of weeks ago my daughter did, but now it's limited there. But
that was quick, yeah.
So, yeah, cool. But, yeah, no, I pick up what you're putting down there, and, yeah, that makes absolute sense. Sorry to cut into you there.
You're all right. So we're going to move right on to the three big things this week because, I mean, there's no real sugarcoating it here. Statistically speaking, like always, Josh Allen, he was 14 for 27, 122 passing yards, two touchdowns, one interception, eight rushes for 42 yards. Now, John, it was Allen's worst offensive output in a game that he both started and finished since October 7th, 2018 versus Tennessee, where he had 82 passing yards and then subsequently went on to miss five games with an elbow injury. Now, Josh Allen said post game, quote, "This team cannot afford to have me play poorly," which he is very, very correct in that assessment. Now, Allen did not look crisp. He was not getting set for his passes. It was kind of a continuation of what we saw against Tennessee. Now, the weather, that's always the big narrative for Josh Allen. You know, this guy could throw in rain, wind, sleet, snow, ice, whatever. It played a factor for both sides. So even though Josh Allen struggled partially because of the weather, it looked like future Hall of Famer Patrick Mahomes did not struggle much at all. So that should really negate that narrative. John, what did you think about Josh Allen's performance or really lack thereof on Monday afternoon?
I have to be completely honest. I was a little concerned. I was concerned that everything that I had been hyping up about the guy, especially over the course of the first 2 to 3 weeks of the season, was, you know, I was starting to look a little outdated with what I was saying. You know, we had seen improvements. We had seen, you know, the Bills win. You know, not in spite of Josh Allen anymore. They were winning because of him. But the opposite side of that is, you know, there's a great chance if you're winning because of somebody that you're probably going to be losing because of somebody as well. And I don't want to say that Josh Allen should shoulder the whole load, at the very least, for the loss to the Chiefs, because the defense didn't give up, or the defense gave up 26 points. The Josh Allen and the offense did not give that up. So I don't want to take away from that. But when I sit here and I look at what's happening here with Josh Allen and I'm sorry, Ryan, we're going to have to cut off just a quick second here.
You're okay. I'm going to keep going on what I'm talking about here. I can pick up where you left off. It does sound like you're a little busy over there. Totally understandable. I think for me, John, Josh Allen's performance, as you mentioned, there's a lot of good we talked about in the past few weeks because Josh Allen has looked really good. Certainly expected him to regress kind of back to the mean. But regressing this hard is very worrisome. Now,
sorry, I had to cut off there because breaking down the wall, as we have mentioned a number of times here, my kids are with me. And of course, the minute the hot mic goes on, the attitude and the amplification, not just from my voice to radio voice, but their voices, because they want to be heard at a time when I tell them, guys, we're on air, chill out for just a little bit, go back to fighting with each other. You know, they fight 24 hours a day. They'll fight with each other 22 hours a day. They'll sleep for the other, you know, for an hour and a half. And that little half hour window, I say, guys, stop with the fighting. They it's like they have the mics in front of them. But basically what I was trying to say, I was concerned with Josh Allen, how he would do against upper echelon teams. It's great to, you know, throw for 400 yards finally, against a New York Jets team or a Miami Dolphins team or whoever the hell he threw 400 yards against. And then consecutive 300 yard games, which up until this point in the season, he had not had those games before. And I wanted to see if that carried over to teams like the Titans, who are quietly really good, and the Kansas City Chiefs, whom everybody's expecting to be at the Super Bowl again. I wanted to see how he would do against those. And as I'm looking at his play, you know, trending downward against those teams, I'm learning that Joe Burrow, in his first three or four games with Cincinnati has thrown for 300 yards in every single one of those. So that was kind of eye-opening for me, I think. And then seeing his performance, I mean, coming into the fourth quarter, Ryan, Josh Allen only had 60-something yards, I believe, before that one drive that ended in the Cole Beasley touchdown that brought him to the 100 yards. And that just will not win you games, especially against teams that you really want to be on par with. You know, if you want to be on par with the Kansas Cities of the world, or at least competitive with them, you can't come into the fourth quarter throwing for 60-something yards.
Yeah, and what I was mentioning while you were off taking care of your home noise issue, I'll mention it again so you can hear it for your I don't know what I'm trying to say, for your listening entertainment, you can hear me say it again.
I'm going to be highly entertained by this. Go on.
Josh Allen has regressed to the mean, but even more so. We certainly knew he was going to do that, but this is very scary because Kansas City is a good team. If you want to make it to the Super Bowl, you're going to have to beat a Kansas City. You're going to have to beat a Tennessee. It's going to be very difficult to get lucky enough to miss out on both of those teams. And to see Josh Allen almost essentially be rendered completely not useless, but just they just turned him right. They just shut him right down, turned it right off. I mean, yeah, he ran the ball for 42 yards, but he did not have much success offensively until late in the game, it felt like.
He didn't have it. And, you know, here is a real hard point that I think hit me. And I don't know if I came up with this point myself because I had been drinking during the game or I had read it somewhere. But this Buffalo Bills team, while they are 4-2 right now, could very easily be 1-5, 2-4, or 3-3.
You need those breaks to end up being a very good team. But I understand the logic there because it's like Buffalo has really walked a very fine line.
Coming hot out the gate against the teams that they should be beating and then get letting off the gas and almost letting them back in there. I mean, dude, they almost lost to Miami in week two. And Miami, they don't look like that pushover team that everybody thought that they might have been coming in there. Like Miami legitimately can punch people in the face and laugh at them. And I'm afraid that, you know, when they meet the Bills for the second time, this is going to be a completely different Miami team. Like they got that swag again going on. And all of a sudden this division, this AFC East division that many felt coming into the season was the Bills to lose. Now all of a sudden people are like, you know, that Miami team, don't sleep on them Dolphins.
Yeah, with the extra roster spot here, I feel like the extra roster spot. Sorry, I'm reading Twitter as I'm talking here. The extra playoff spot, I really do think it's going to increase the level of competition. But again, it's a situation where even though you've got a team like Miami where they can say, look, we're going to start Tua Tagovailoa, which they're doing, because they are able to take a shot and say, look, we think he's ready. We're going to try to make a push for this playoff, for a playoff berth, because there's an extra spot available. Whereas on the other side of things, you can't be like the Buffalo Bills or you can't sit back and think to yourself, oh, you know what? We'll be fine. We'll make it to the playoffs because there's an extra team available. You have to actually try to work your ass off and get better and better with each and every single game, because you know what? If you don't, your season's going to end pretty quickly. And again, it's a situation where the Buffalo Bills defense is not good. And we can talk about that right now, honestly.
You know what? That's a great segue to the next question I was actually going to ask you. Not necessarily related to the three big things, but related to the Bills defense. I am faced with a choice right now in one of my fantasy football leagues, and I'm putting you on the spot right now.
Okay.
Do I start the Buffalo Bills defense against the New York Jets, who I just learned they've downgraded Jamison Crowder to doubtful? So it's basically Sam Darnold and a bunch of ex-CFLers against the Buffalo Bills defense, who couldn't stop a nosebleed the last 2 weeks. Or do I start Tampa Bay's defense against a depleted Las Vegas Raiders team, whom has about four of their offensive linemen on the COVID list right now?
I mean,
I don't need an answer right now. Maybe by the end of the podcast.
I think risk reward, I would go with the Bills. Why not? They have to have a good game at some point in time.
You think so?
Yeah, why not?
Okay. Because right now I have the Bucks lined up in there, but I'm looking at the matchup between the Bills and the Jets right now, kind of pre-gaming it, so to speak, and I'm like, you know, I mean, this isn't the same Jets team that we're making a comeback in the second half of week one. So I honestly think this is going to be a bye week for the Bills, but like, I don't know. Anyways, I'm sorry. Bills defense.
That's okay. The Bills defense, how much longer, John, can they go before making a big change? Defensive end Trent Murphy, defensive tackle Harrison Phillips were healthy scratches for the game. They allowed 245 rushing yards, 161 to Clyde Edwards-Helaire on 26 carries alone. They did not look good. They have not looked good. They cannot get any sort of pressure from the defensive line. They're struggling to get sacks. It's really affecting the cornerbacks who have aside from really Trey White, who missed the game against Tennessee, which I believe from what I'm gathering here is because of the potential for COVID, just sit out the game. Don't put yourself at risk for that. That's just obviously just presuming, just judging by the offseason. But aside from really Trey White, the Bills cornerbacks have been unhealthy. You've got Levi Wallace sick, Josh Norman's out. I mean, it's a situation where they have to get healthy, but also they have to be effective because you're not going to win many games allowing 245 rushing yards. That's for damn sure.
Well, right. But you're also, they could take comfort in knowing that they're at the very least this next week, they're not playing the Kansas City Chiefs.
Sure.
They're playing a winless football team that, you know, they are so bad that calling them bad is an insult to bad things. That is how bad that they are.
Well, say so that because I want to get your thoughts on the Jets because I know.
No,
twice a year, we're good.
I'll give you the thoughts about the Jets at the appropriate time. But if there's any chance for this defense that has been on the ropes to kind of get off of those ropes and start punching back and building a confidence, this week is that week for that to happen.
Also, the reason I keep getting distracted during this podcast right now is there's a fight happening on UFC 254. The fighters, it's Volkov versus Harris. Volkov is I think he's 6'7". He's a big old Russian dude. He's got a gigantic back piece that looks like something off of a Nickelodeon TV show, Are You Afraid of the Dark? And I also think he may have just kicked this guy in the penis or severely injured him.
Okay.
I'm not sure. Anyways, digging in deeper here. He's hunched over. He got his midsection, his actual gut is messed up. Anyways.
Oh, all right.
Buffalo's defense, digging a little deeper. Their inability to make a stop was grossly abused on Monday night as well. Kansas City, John, 9-for-14 on third downs. How the hell are you supposed to get the ball back and try to have any forward momentum when they're 9-for-14 on third downs? Not to mention, Buffalo took two undisciplined personal foul penalties late in the game, which extended drives for Kansas City. And really, Buffalo, you could see themselves getting momentum. Third down comes great. They made the stop. Nope. Flag. Personal foul penalty. And it wasn't like a mistake. It was, okay, the guy's out of bounds and we're going to tackle him and throw him, 10 more feet while he's already out of bounds, while the whistle's already been blown. And you're like, you guys, and these are not rookies that are doing it. Mm-hmm. If I'm not mistaken, it was Jordan Poyer and Trey White, who had the two penalties. So you think to yourself, what the hell's going on there?
Well, I think a lot of that is frustration. A lot of the players, and this includes Josh Allen as well.
Sure.
And we've talked about this actually a few times during the game when Allen started to struggle, you would see he would get visibly frustrated, and that visible frustration led to a lot of mistakes, led to inconsistent play, and ultimately led to losses. And that seems to be what's happening, I don't want to say that that's the complete culture in Orchard Park, but it seems like when things are good, things are really, really good with everybody in the Buffalo Bills. Everybody's all smiles and high fives and hugs and, or elbow bumps or whatever. But when the slightest thing goes bad, it's seriously, they channel Bills Mafia Twitter with one call, and all of a sudden, because Bills, you're laughing now because
I know exactly what I'm talking about.
Bills Mafia Twitter, one wrong call goes the wrong way. And all of a sudden it's the, oh, the refs don't want to see the Buffalo Bills succeed and the referees this and blah, blah, blah. And it's doom and gloom and all that crap. And it's like, at least this year, it seems to be when something doesn't go their way, it's like, I don't know if they have the, if they have Twitter being read out in the helmets or something. Because they like seriously get frustrated. They get mad. And when they get frustrated and they get mad and flustered, they're making the mistakes that they're making, like they did on defense, as you had mentioned.
We've seen the past couple games too, where Josh Allen just kind of says he goes to the, he looks like he, a card carrying member of the Rex Grossman "fuck it, I'm going deep" fan club and just heaves it up.
Yes.
And you're like, dude, you know what?
No more accurate description. Oh my God, I'm gonna be watching this game tomorrow. And in the midst of crying about how bad the Jets are going to be, I'm going to be laughing every time Josh Allen, you know, throws, because now I'm going to think of Rex Grossman of all people.
That is a memory Bears fans wish they could forget.
Yeah. Grossman at the Super Bowl nearly losing his lunch like McNabb did and at the Super Bowl. Like, yikes.
I'm interested.
Sexy Rexy, baby.
Yeah, Sexy Rexy is right. He was the first incarnation of Sexy Rexy. Anyways, the offensive line also, John, a liability. Last week we mentioned Devin Singletary's inability to get going on the ground, but it really is starting to appear to be a bigger issue than that. First off, Cody Ford left the game with a knee injury, and we'll talk a little bit more about him here shortly. But, John, it just seems like the Buffalo Bills offensive line, a strength last year, is now very much a weakness for this team.
Would you dare say, Ryan, that the offensive line has been offensive?
I would say that.
Dad joke. That's a bad dad joke.
That is
a major issue there. Like, I mean, both sides of the ball, their line is not the same as it was last year, or at the very least playing to the same level that they were last year. And that was a huge strength for them in their playoff push last year for the wild card. You know, again, I go back to my state of the Dolphins. I don't know how worried I am about Cam Newton and the Patriots, at least at this point in time. That train doesn't seem to be moving very well or very fast, like maybe wild card contention. I'm more concerned about Miami and the swag that they're all of a sudden getting now. If they can't get it together on both sides of the ball, particularly the lines, and they can't, and in the offense, on the offensive side, like we mentioned earlier in the season, with getting that running game going so Josh Allen doesn't have to shoulder the load to get that, you know, get the ball moving, the chains moving in the offensive side of it. If that offensive line can't open up those holes and give Devin Singletary some room to run and advance the ball and take some of the pressure off of Josh Allen and his legs and his arm, then the Bills are going to be in some serious trouble.
Yeah, I mean, again, we'll talk about it in just a few minutes, but it definitely seems like the Buffalo Bills need to come out and have a complete 180 performance of the last 2 weeks, because at this point, man, like it's crazy how much goodwill the Buffalo Bills had built up, and then they've just kind of broke it back down. And
you're beating the crap out of teams you should be beating the crap out of.
Correct. You know, so they look good against bad teams, but then when they play good teams, so all that goodwill that they built up against good teams beating bad teams, you're like, okay, this team, they should be good enough to make the playoffs. And then they play good teams who, dare I say, Kansas City and Tennessee are better than the Bills, not only because they've lost to both teams, but also because we know Kansas City won the Super Bowl. Tennessee was close to a trip to the Super Bowl. Didn't they, if I remember correctly, because last year, John, honestly, it feels like this year has taken about 17 years to finish. If I'm not mistaken, wasn't it Kansas City versus Tennessee, winner goes to the Super Bowl last year?
It sure was. That was the AFC championship game.
They were the two best teams in the AFC last year, and they look to be the two best teams in the AFC this year. So as much as things,
well, I mean, two of them, maybe three. Let's not sleep on the Steelers now that Big Ben is back, and how they've been playing too.
I'm not sleeping on the Steelers. I'm not sleeping on anybody else. I'm just saying for the sake of argumentation here, because it fits perfectly into my little angry podcast narrative. You look at the Tennessee Titans. You look at the Kansas City Chiefs. They appear to be two of the best teams in the AFC. So the Buffalo Bills, while they shouldn't be so hard on themselves, it's also very disheartening and disappointing to see them struggle against such good teams.
I see that point of it, and I'll raise you the fact that if they want to get to the level of being in the conversation of two or the three, you know, best teams in the AFC, they have to show up for them. And they just did not do that. They did not do that with Tennessee, and I think that Tennessee – of the two, the last 2 weeks, I would argue that Tennessee would probably be the, I hate to say easier team, as in like they're not good in comparison to the Chiefs, but the Chiefs are a more complete team. Like they can defeat you in many, many different ways.
Well, not
and
to
Ryan,
mention,
and Ryan Tannehill, don't
sign Le'Veon Bell.
Yeah, where they just signed Le'Veon Bell. They got lightning in a bottle with Edwards-Helaire. And then got Le'Veon Bell. And so like they can beat you in a multitude of different ways. Like Ryan Tannehill has been playing MVP caliber football this year and has been a completely different quarterback since being released off of the grips of Adam Gase. And I don't want to discredit that and their receivers and everything, but a bulk of their offense goes through, just one of the largest human beings I've ever seen on my TV screen, Derrick Henry. And if you're a coach like Bill Belichick, whom typically zones in on whatever the biggest weapon is and takes that out, you know, I would be, if the Bills zoned in on Derrick Henry and made their whole defensive scheme on stopping him, I don't know. It could go either way with Ryan Tannehill beating you by with his arm. If you zone in and stop Edwards-Helaire on, you know, for Kansas City, Mahomes is still going to beat you. If you zone in on Mahomes and his passing ability, he's going to find a way to get out of the pocket and find one of his weapons. Like that's a different dynamic than was Tennessee. Tennessee would have been a great statement, a great we're here game for Buffalo.
I agree.
They did not do that. So that to me tells me the Bills at best are wild card and perhaps backing into wild card at this point, considering how Miami has been playing of late.
Well, and we're not going to talk about it yet because I did ask some friends and I said, okay, when's I was going to start this week, just to be completely honest with you, about if the season ended today, this is where the Bills will be in the playoffs, but it's a little early. We're going to wait a couple more weeks for that. But at this point,
Bills fans have been doing that since the NFL announced they weren't canceling.
I understand that. But we're trying to keep some sort of journalistic integrity here, you know? So that's why I asked and said, when is early enough? And then when I get told, okay, it's going to be week 10 is good. I said, okay, perfectly fine. Then I will make sure to start on week 10 and then go forward from there. So with that being said, we are not going to talk about that right now, but what we are going to do is we are going to take a commercial break, John. So right after this quick commercial break, we will be back with more Trust the Podcast.
Episode 69.
Bills make me wanna shout, kick your heels up
and we're back here on Trust the Podcast, episode number 69. Come on now, normally we don't normally mention the episode number throughout the podcast, but I am going for the cheap pop from John every time I can get it. Like today when I text him a photo of myself in a baby blue dress shirt and a black bow tie, and I knew he would get the reference immediately. I had to explain it to my wife, who still doesn't understand it, but I told her, I said, that was many moons ago, but it never ceases to bring back the memories.
Okay, so for all of you listening and that have followed my history, my personal history, in a previous life, I was a pro wrestler, and it was back in, I believe, 2004, when Ryan must have been like 9 years old. I have no idea.
13.
Oh, you're 13 years old. Okay. I was 24 or 25 at the time. But anywho, Ryan in an he was there. I think you were there with Eric.
Yep.
And you know, Eric was aspiring at that time to be a pro wrestler. Obviously, he became one and did some wonderful things. But Ryan was the referee for the match between myself and a very young Eric Amanon. And he had the blue shirt with the bow tie. And I think that might have been, correct me if I'm wrong, I think I might have suggested that to you just because I thought it would have been funny to have a referee dressed like a referee from 1980s WWE. And to my surprise, you actually did that. And you were a referee. I don't know who gave you the name Pistol Pete. It certainly wasn't me. But that name stuck, and you were the referee in the old 1980s WWE wrestling garb. So when you sent me the picture today, in wrestling terminology, I popped.
I love it. I knew it. I was like, I got to send the Snapchat over to John. He's going to absolutely love it. And here yes. we are.
I don't know that Perez picked up on that. I don't know that he picked up on that. Of course, if he hears now, he'll probably be like, yeah, I did.
And I'll be like, you know what he'll say? You know what he'll say? Okay. Cool.
Yeah, I'll be like that too.
Anyways, our third of the three big things this week before we move on to our look ahead real quick, John, is it time to worry about Tremaine Edmonds? Now, the defensive captain has suffered what appears to be a massive amount of regression so far this season. He is reportedly playing through a shoulder injury. We saw him. He was missing assignments, flat out beat on Monday night. Often appear to be going instinct over reading plays, was fooled on multiple plays, spotted running into another teammate on a pass over the middle at least one occasion. Now, ex-Buffalo Bill linebacker Lorenzo Alexander said on Twitter, quote, this guy being Tremaine Edmonds is battling through a lot right now. He will be more than fine staying at middle linebacker. The only difference is a shoulder injury, and to play the run, you have to use your hands. Hard to do when you have pain every time you strike 300-plus pound linemen. Long-term, he'll be great. Had to make it work until he gets healthy. Now, with that being said, making it work till he gets healthy, and we can make this very quickly, this point very quick, I should say. Do you think that the Buffalo Bills are better off with an injured Tremaine Edmonds in the lineup, or do you think they need to shut him down and say, look, you're hurting yourself. You're not getting much better. You're not getting better quickly. You're clearly struggling, and it's hurting the defense. We need you to get healthy. We need you to sit out, or should they let him keep playing?
I think the best thing for them to do at this point would be, especially this week, sit him. If he's hurting that bad, you know, and it's hard to tell an athlete you can't do something when they know they can, or they historically have been able to play, you know, play hurt, play a little hurt, you know, play a little longer, a couple minutes longer than they did before and things like that, you know. But the fact is if you're playing hurt and it's hurting not only you even more, but hurting your team, probably best at this point to sit him and rest him and use him in situations in an absolute emergency. When you're playing, you know, when you're playing depleted teams like the Jets right now, sit him.
I mean, John, you and I both have watched the Bills enough this season to see that this is not the same Tremaine Edmonds we've seen before. I mean, he's young, he makes mistakes, but it seems like he was learning from them and growing from them. And then this season, it's just been a complete 180. It seems like instead of, you know, taking a step back to take two steps forward, it's like taking a step back to take two steps back to take another two steps back, because it just seems like you watch like the game against the Chiefs where you're watching the run play and it's a play he's made before, and he just completely hits the wrong gap, and then there's a wide open hole for Edwards-Helaire to make a nice gain.
Right, but is he
thinking too much? Where like is he regressing? Where you're like, okay, he's just not good, or is it the injury that's really causing this?
And it could be the injury, but it also could be he's overcompensating for what the rest of the defense isn't doing. So maybe
there's a lot of factors here. Maybe
he's putting a lot of pressure on himself to make sure that the defense performs and, you know, maybe to try to be that example to, you know, that the defense could rally around and be like, you know, that's our leader, that's our guy, we got to play for him. And by doing that and playing injured, he's actually doing more harm than good, which is why I go back to saying, okay, we know he's injured, we know he's struggling, but we know we essentially have a bye week this week against the Jets. Let him sit, let him rest, let him relax, give him an extra day off to catch up and go from there. because you got the Patriots the following week. So, you know, regardless of what their win-loss record is, it's still a Bill Belichick coached team. They're gonna zone in on someone that's hurt or someone that's playing too much or that, you know. So I would say, if anything, this week would be the week to sit him.
I don't disagree. At some point in time, either something's got to give. Either he's got to get healthy and be playing better, or they've got to just say, look, this is best for you. But it's something we're going to keep an eye on. Now that we've mentioned it in the podcast, we tend to keep our eye on things we talk about because we're not forgetful like that. But to wrap this thing up, John, we're going to take it home with our look ahead brought to you by 26 Shirts. I'm going to throw this little plug out there.
Do we have to?
Home of the original Bills Mafia. We're just going to leave that nugget there. 26shirts.com.
I get what you mean by that.
26shirts.com, facebook.com/26shirts, at 26 shirts on Twitter and Instagram. John, our look ahead, Sunday, October 25th, Buffalo Bills at the New York Jets. Now, first off, before we talk about that game, there's a lot more news to talk about that really has broken since we sat down to speak about this podcast. Mm-hmm. And I guess sat down to get the podcast started. First off, a couple days ago, or yesterday, I should say, the 23rd of October, the Buffalo Bills announced that wide receiver John Brown, cornerback Josh Norman, guard Cody Ford, tight end Dawson Knox, we'll talk about in a second, and linebacker Tyrell Dodson ruled out for Sunday's game per Friday's injury report. Cornerback Tre'Davious White, cornerback Cam Lewis, linebacker Matt Milano are listed as questionable for Sunday. Now, with that being said, the breaking news of the day on Saturday, officially from at Buffalo Bills PR on Twitter, quote, the Buffalo Bills were informed this morning that tight end Dawson Knox, he's not a vacuum cleaner, he's a tight end, has tested positive for COVID-19. Knox was placed on the reserved COVID-19 list per NFL contact tracing protocols. Three other players, all tight ends, tight end Lee Smith, tight end Tommy Sweeney, currently on the PUP list, and practice squad tight end Nate Becker have been defined to have been in close contact with Knox and were also placed on the reserve COVID-19 list and will miss Sunday's game. The Bills have elevated the following players from the practice squad for Sunday's game with the Jets: wide receiver Duke Williams, offensive line Jordan Devi, linebacker Andre Smith, and cornerback Dane Jackson. In addition, linebacker Tyrell Dodson was placed on the injured reserve list with a hamstring injury. The team will continue preparation for Sunday's game and will travel as scheduled this afternoon. Now, John, the one tight end that we did mention is Tyler Croft, and Adam Schefter has the scoop on that. Quote, Bills tight end Tyler Croft was spared from the outbreak that hit his unit Friday, and here's why. His wife Alexa was in labor for more than 24 hours and delivered baby Grace around 5 a.m. Friday morning. Tyler Croft was at practice Friday but missed the meetings where the virus was allegedly passed. So first off, good on you, Tyler Croft. Congratulations on the baby. And in typical Episode 69 fashion, we must congratulate you on the sex.
Very nice. As my friend Borat would say, it's very nice to make a sexy time, have a baby. Very good.
So with that being said, going from the very good, happy time, make a sex to the New York Jets, who are the opposite of that.
New York Jets, 0-6. Have all of the pubes still.
0-6.
I watched the movie yesterday.
it was very good. It was very good. It's a must see.
Yes.
The New York Jets, 0-6. I didn't believe this. I had to double check it, John. They're averaging 12.5 points per game and allowing 30.8 points per game. I can't remember the last time I saw that big of a flip offense to defense, but they've been without quarterback Sam Darnold. He'll return to the lineup after recovering from a sprained AC joint in his shoulder.
But he's probably not going to have his main target.
I was going to ask you that. Elite Joe Flacco led the Jets to the last two losses. And with that being said, John, the floor is yours. Let us know how you're feeling about the Jets.
I mean, Jets. Just end the season at this point for them.
That's funny. I didn't even realize that.
They are. You're welcome. It's older than you are, but you're welcome.
Oh, man. I've never heard that before.
Well, I've lived through 1-15 with the New York Jets in 1996. So I believe that's probably where I first heard it.
You know what? I got a question for you. Screw talking about the Jets, because it's going to be bad either way. Because if the Jets win, it's going to be bad for the Bills. And if the Bills win, it'll probably end up being bad for the Jets. Can we agree on that one?
No, I don't think it would be bad for the Jets at all. The only way it would be bad for the Jets. Okay, so here's the
I'm saying if the Bills win, it's probably going to be a bad afternoon for the Jets. They're going to have a bad game. Whereas if the Bills lose,
it's been a bad season for the Jets.
I get that.
Everybody's been beating them.
I just want to ask you a question about the Jets.
This is what Jets fans are legitimately rooting for. Bills Mafia, what Jets fans are legitimately rooting for at this point, it ain't Trevor Lawrence. I know the sexy talk about, you know, Trevor Lawrence coming out of the draft. He's going to be the first. They're tanking for Trevor. No, they're not tanking for Trevor. This is a completely 100% unintentional tank by the New York Jets. It's Adam Gase is that bad as a head coach. If Adam Gase would, if my kids wanted to play football at a peewee league level and needed a coach, I would not recommend Adam Gase coach that team because he is that bad. He's lost all of his players. He's lost the locker room. Greg Williams don't like him. They're battling it out. This is a very, 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 very piss poor, terrible, sorry ass football team that literally nobody's afraid of. What was your question? I don't know. I just wanted to ramble here.
That's okay. That's okay. I would presume, first off, the Jets will fire Adam Gase after this season. Adam Gase tried to ruin the career of Ryan Tannehill, who, in the right system, is doing perfectly fine with the Tennessee Titans, who, mind you, in a specific set of games, has had as good of numbers, if not better, than Patrick Mahomes.
Ryan Tannehill won Comeback Player of the Year last year. Do you know what he came back from?
Adam Gase.
Being coached by Adam Gase.
That's
Comeback
bad.
Player of the Year award is usually reserved for people that Alex Smith's going to win that award this year
because his leg almost had to be amputated.
As he should, it would be completely rigged if anybody other than Alex Smith won that award this year. But that's that award is usually for somebody coming back from some kind of debilitating injury or something, some surgery. I mean, Chad Pennington, when he was a Jets quarterback, he won it twice. And the reason why he won it twice was because the season that he came back from having two separate shoulder surgeries, he came back and did very, very well and got the Jets to the playoffs in the wild card spot each of those 2 years. And so that's what that Comeback Player of the Year is for. The year that Adrian Peterson won MVP, it was a toss up between Adrian Peterson and Peyton Manning, but they both were injured the year beforehand, so it was a toss up. One was winning MVP, one was winning Comeback Player of the Year. Peyton Manning won Comeback Player of the Year. Adrian Peterson won MVP. Peyton Manning came back, won Comeback Player of the Year after having his freaking neck fused together, and he ended up being, you know, Super Manning that year. Ryan Tannehill in 2019 was the Comeback Player of the Year, coming back from being released by the Dolphins after being coached by Adam Gase.
I mean, Adam Gase is pretty bad. So I guess that creates another question for me too. First off, do you think that are you buying the rumors that the Jets are looking to move on from Sam Darnold?
I don't know. And I say I don't know because this organization is so incompetent and inept at the game of football since the Johnson family took over from the Hess family. It's possible, but here's the thing. With Sam Darnold, ever since he was drafted, the Jets have gone 11-19 in that stretch. Now, the time that Darnold was injured a couple of games in his rookie year, the mono last year, and now the shoulder issue this year, in 8 games since Darnold has been drafted that he has not started, the New York Jets are 0-8. They are 0-8 without him. They are 11-19 with him. Get that man some weapons. Yeah. There's nothing. Sam Darnold is not the problem.
Protect that man too.
So for me, I don't think that they should get away from Sam Darnold. I don't think Sam Darnold is a bad quarterback. He is a good quarterback on a very, very shitty team.
So then my follow-up question for you then is, say the Jets do draft first overall, and we'll talk about this later in the season when the Jets play the Bills again, and we'll see where they're at. But if they have the opportunity to draft,
this is the second time they're playing. This is done.
I'm shot. We'll talk about it later in the year anyways, either on BLTD podcast or on this podcast, whatever, because it's important to the Buffalo Bills, to the future of the Buffalo Bills. If the Jets have the chance to draft Trevor Lawrence, do you think they would be dumb enough to pass that up? Because he looks like as sure of a thing as we've seen in a very long time, but they have Sam Darnold.
If they don't put anything around him, he's gonna be no better than Jamarcus Russell.
I don't disagree with you.
Doesn't matter who's behind there. They could have brought Brady in, and if they put Tom Brady in with this team, they're not winning either.
Look at it. If Tom Brady signed with the Jets, you know that video where the guys are dancing with the casket? That's what would happen.
Yeah, well, that's I think what Trevor Lawrence is thinking right now is like, uh-oh, you know. But that said, if they lost in how bad the Jets are, is how good their GM could possibly be. And this is probably better suited for BLTD, but again, it's AFC East related, so I suppose it could translate here. But he's got like I think 3 first round picks. And then, or 4 first round picks, I think, in the next 2 years, 2 of them being next year. So he's stashing the picks. What I don't know and what I don't understand is what he's going to do with them. If they get the first overall pick, again, I don't think they need Trevor Lawrence. I think they have a good franchise quarterback in Sam Darnold. He has proven that with a poor team around him. I think if they do secure the number one overall pick, that it changes the trajectory for them. They could turn around and flip that pick for a number of you know, star players or multiple number ones, because someone's going to want, you know, and maybe it's Indianapolis, maybe it's whoever else needs a quarter. Maybe it could be Cleveland if they decide to move away from Baker Mayfield. There could be a lot of capital in that one pick to a team that may or may not need Trevor Lawrence. Where the Jets come and remind everybody that they're the Jets is that they historically have not made very good decisions on either side of the ball, in any way, shape, or form. So for me, I could see them dangling the pick and not getting what they want, and then drafting Trevor Lawrence, and then, you know, having to trade Sam Darnold to, I don't know, let's just say Pittsburgh for a third round pick, because you're not going to get, you know, first or second round for Sam Darnold at this point in time. And then Darnold turns around and lights that franchise up and, you know, gets the playoffs and wins a Super Bowl and all that stuff. So it has the tendency to be very Jets like, regardless of what direction. Like, as a Jets fan, I don't know how to feel about any of this. I just know I want Adam Gase gone. He's a terrible head coach. This is a bye week for the Buffalo Bills, essentially. Jameson Crowder downgraded to doubtful, and bringing back Sam Darnold in time to get killed by the Bills defense. Like,
I've got to give it to you, man. It's hard to watch the Jets every week. You see the highlights, and they just get worse and worse and worse.
I didn't even watch them last week at all. Like, there was no reason I needed to watch them. Well, I will watch them this week, obviously,
sure,
because it will be on TV, and obviously as a co-host of a Bills Talk podcast that, you know, sympathizes with the Jets, I'm going to have to put myself through this. But yeah, it's.
And we'll talk about it either way.
If you're in a survivor league, pick the Bills. That's surefire bet.
Hey, that's fair. That's absolutely fair. Now, let's wrap this bad boy up. We'll get this podcast up and running. Sorry it came so late. We'll try not to make that happen again next week, because the game's happening at Sunday at 1 o'clock. So it'll be much better, much easier for us to get a podcast in, because our schedule will be back to normal. So that being said, I'm Ryan Wolfe at Wolfe BLTD. John is at IamJCMoney. We are Trust the Podcast.
And for the 69th time on this podcast, I will say you're not.
Never forget that the Chicago Bears almost won a Super Bowl with a very mediocre, albeit maybe even potentially bad, Rex Grossman. And as always, let's go Bills.
Oh, Rex Grossman.
The preceding presentation has been brought to you by the Gear Network.